Well, welcome to the service today and this special weekend, the 4th of July weekend. We want to pay extra special attention to our country today. And so we want to stand as you stand together this morning. Our choir is going to sing the Star Spangled Banner.
Celebrate the great country in which we live. I'd like for you to stand with me if you would and join me in as we give our pledges this morning. We are so blessed to live in such a great country, and so let's just give thanks unto God for the freedoms that we have as we pledge our allegiance to the American flag. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We also are so blessed for the freedoms that we can experience in Christ. So let's pledge our allegiance to Christ through the Christian flag. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag, and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one brotherhood, united in all mankind, in service and love. Let's also just give thanks unto God for His holy word. Let's just pledge our allegiance today to God's Bible. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, and will hide His words in my heart, that I might not sin against God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. I'd like to read a prayer that was given by the Reverend Peter Marshall. He was the chaplain for the United States Senate. And so let me just read this prayer to you, because I think it is so fitting. Even though it was given back in 1948, it still speaks to today. With our heads bowed, listen to this prayer. Our Father, we pray for this land. We need thy help in this time of testing and uncertainty. May we begin to see that all true Americanism begins in being Christian, that it can have no other foundation. To thy glory was this republic established. For the advancement of the Christian faith did the founding fathers give their life's heritage passed down to us. We pray that all over this land there may be a return to the faith of these men and women who trusted God as they faced the perils and the dangers of the frontier. Thou did bless their efforts. Thou did bless America. Thou hast made her rich. Thou also make her good. Make us, the citizens of this land, want to do the right thing. Make us long to have the right attitudes. Help us to be Christian in our attitudes. Bless those who bear responsibility. May they be led by thee to do that which is right, rather than that which is expedient or politically wise. Bless this land that we love so much, our Father. Help her to deposit her trust, not in armies and wealth and material resources, or in achievements of the human mind, but in that righteousness which alone exalts a nation, and by which alone peace can finally come to us. This we ask in the name that is above every name, thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. O Lord, what an appropriate prayer to pray for our country and for ourselves. Lord, we pray for this great land in which we live because she's sick. She needs healing. And we know that healing only comes from you. So, oh Lord, we just pray that you begin in us, the house of God, Christians, and do a fresh work in our lives that we might be in tune with you. And God, we pray that revival would spread across our land, that people would see that the answer for the problems we face in this land are found in Jesus Christ, that your word is to guide us and to lead us. Oh God, help us as a nation to repent of our sin and evils that have created so much chaos in our country. And God, help us to turn to the one who led us to found this country. We ask that you forgive us of our sin and heal our land. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. If you would be seated. And again, we'd like to thank you for being here. And we pray that today will be so meaningful of being in the house of God as we thank God for this great land in which we live. And let me just say, if you are our guest today, we hope that you've gotten a guest card. And if you fill it out and just drop it in the offering plate a little bit later on, we certainly want a record of your visit, and we just are so honored that you've chosen to worship with us here today at Poplar Corner Baptist Church. Let me just remind you, this is a holiday weekend, and because of that, we don't have choir rehearsal or services tonight, and hopefully you'll take time to be with your family and to celebrate just being together, and that's very important. Also, if you notice in your bulletin, we have some upcoming trips that are planned and things of that nature, so we hope that you'll mark your calendars for these. And one of the things that we're going to plan on doing in just a few weeks, we're going to be doing some backyard Bible clubs here in our subdivision, and you can look at the dates there. If you'd like to help with any of those, just let me know. Okay? All right. But thank you for being here today, and we just pray the Lord will be exalted. After the service today, we'd like to invite you to join us in the gym. And there's a great meal prepared. There's plenty of food. The meal will be served to you, and the ladies are wearing masks, and they have gloves on, and we'll do everything to try to be safe, okay? So we hope that you'll join us. Okay, Brother John, come and lead us.
It is great to be in God's house today. And when I think of Peter Marshall, that great chaplain of the Senate, think of his dear wife, Catherine Marshall, who was a dear writer, Christian writer, wrote some wonderful stuff. If you haven't ever read any of Catherine Marshall's writings, you need to look that up and read some of those. And there was a movie made, and I've been trying to think of the name of it, Peter Marshall. Can you remember the name? No, something else. I mean, anyway, there's a movie about Peter Marshall, too. He was a great, great man of God. So thank God for that. And by the way, the year that that prayer was prayed was the year that I was born. So you can add that up and say, oh, my. Anyway. Well, this morning, as I've told a bunch of people, if you cut me, I would bleed red, white, and blue. I just love this country so much, and all the people that have served our country. I was telling Kathy, I want to thank Kathy so much for the decorations, because I walked in here Wednesday morning, and she had not even completed this, I don't believe, but I walked in here Wednesday morning and saw this decoration on the table, and I just had to stand there, and I wept, I guarantee you, because of the our country and what we're going through right now, especially. And I want to thank Kathy for this beautiful decoration here this morning. So thank you so much. I know that we have had a lot of guys and gals that have served our country, even some that are serving now, and we do want to pray for them. But we want to honor those who have served our country this morning. And if you have served in any branch of the services in the past, would you please stand right now where we can honor you? Is anyone here that has served in the Army, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard, Marines? Amen. Let's give all of you a hand. Family here this morning that you have lost someone in the service, someone that in your family has died in the service. Is anyone here that has happened to you? Anyone, would you stand so we can honor you this morning? Amen. Thank you. Amen. Well, thank the Lord. We want to sing some great songs of America this morning. So if you would stand, we're going to begin with that great song, America the Beautiful, and go from there. Yeah. salvation.
If tomorrow all things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, where the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away.
Steve May was supposed to do that this morning, and he was scheduled to do that, but he became sick this morning, and so we replaced him with Lee Greenwood. So, all right. If you would turn to Psalm 80 this morning, and this morning we want to look at a psalm, and as you read it, if you really pay attention to what it is saying, it almost sounds like it is describing what is happening in America today. We're going to read just the first 7 verses, but we're really going to look at all 19 verses. And so I really encourage you to take your Bibles and follow along and take some notations here. Psalm 80, give ear, O shepherd of Israel, thou that leadest Joseph like a flock, thou that dwellest between the cherubims, shine forth before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh. Stir up thy strength and come and save us. Turn us again, O God, and cause thy face to shine, and we shall be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long wilt thou be angry against the prayer of thy people? Thou feedest them with the bread of tears. Thou givest them tears to drink in great measure. Thou makest us a strife unto our neighbors, and our enemies laugh among themselves. Turn us again, O God of hosts, and cause thy face to shine, and we shall be saved. There's no doubt that we are living in historical times. In just a matter of weeks, you know, life has changed in America dramatically. Certainly the coronavirus has made life different for us here in our land. Up until just a few months ago, we never heard the term social distancing. Just a few months ago, you find that churches were closed, schools were closed, businesses were closed, sporting events were closed, political events were closed, all shut down. And though we're gradually getting back to a little more normal pace of life, we still are being affected in that sense. Now we're told, you know, to shop in a store or to eat at a restaurant, you have to wear a mask or you have to social distance yourself. And so in just a short span of time, you find that life looks a little different in America. And certainly since we've had the racial tension with the death of George Floyd, and what are we seeing? We are seeing such negative steps being taken toward law enforcement. We are seeing the tearing down of statues which have reflected our history, both the good and the bad of our history. We've seen rioting and looting, and we've seen a media that is pushing such a liberal agenda instead of just reporting the news. And I say all that this morning to say, very simply, we're in a mess, aren't we? We're in a mess. And may I say, it seems to be something of the consequences of forgetting God and turning away from God. And as I said last Sunday night, sometimes God just sort of steps back and God just says, okay, this is what you want. This is what you'll get. And we're eating the fruits of leaving God out of this land. The psalmist said in Psalm 85, he said, Lord, you have been favorable unto thy land. And he's speaking to the nation of Israel. I like the New Living Translation. It says, Lord, you poured out your blessings on our land. Isn't that true? That God has so poured his blessings out upon us in this land. He has been so good to us, and yet it seems like we have turned our backs on him. When Asaph, if you notice the subtitle there, Asaph wrote this. He was a true patriot. Remember, Asaph was, the chief musician, and even musicians have some spiritual insights, as he writes. And you find that he was a patriot. And you know, a patriot is someone who loves their country. A patriot is someone who is loyal and zealous in support of their country. And he loved his country, and being a man of God, he looked at his country and he felt such a tremendous burden. Because he saw his country moving from being such a blessed land to being in bondage. Now, I don't know about you, but I love Mike Lindell. Mike Lindell is the founder and the chief executive officer of MyPillow. Have you seen his commercials? He's always got that blue shirt on. He's always got a cross. And his story is quite remarkable. But back in March, he was at a press conference with President Trump in the Rose Garden. And he made some comments like this. He said, you know, God had been taken out of our schools and our lives. We've become a nation that had turned its back on God. And he said, you know, again, back in March, he said, I just want to encourage people, while you're being at home, to get back into the Word of God. Read your Bibles and spend time with your families. Well, to no surprise, the liberal media was all over him for saying stuff like that. And you're thinking, what insanity that people would think, hey, reading the Bible and spending time with family would be bad for America. But that's basically the mentality and the attitude that we have, particularly through the media, that, hey, reading the Bible and spending time with family is bad. Mike Lindell knows that faith and family are the bedrock of our society. Well, in Psalm 80, you have some striking parallels between Israel and America. As you read Israel's history in the Bible, you find that there was a cycle that seemed to repeat itself. God had blessed them, and yet they would stray away from God, and God would allow them to be chastised, and then they would be brought back to God. And as you read Psalm 80, I hope as we look at this and do sort of the exegesis of Psalm 80, you will see that it's like describing our own country. Somebody said that right now it feels like our nation has one foot on a banana peel and the other foot on an ice cube. And it seems that way, doesn't it? You never know when you turn the news on what's happening next. So I want you to follow along with me this morning in Psalm 80. And I want you to notice four things. The first thing I want you to notice is what I just read. It's what I call the heartfelt prayer. Asaph is praying. And you can sense his passion. You can sense his heart. I mean, the prayer was not one of these, now I lay me down to sleep type of prayers. He's crying out to God. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel. He's calling on God. Please listen to us. Give ear. He says, stir up your strength. Save us. Come and save us. Turn us again, O God. Cause your face to shine and we shall be saved. O God, O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry against the prayer of your people? And what do you sense? You sense a prayer. You sense a man crying out. Hear us, shepherd of Israel. Now, we're not sure exactly the setting of this particular psalm. Some tend to think that it came after the Assyrians had overcome the northern nation and taken them into captivity. But whatever the historical situation was, it was bad. And when he wrote this, the nation was at a time of national calamity. You know, calamities have a way of getting us to cry out to God, don't they? And so at a time of national calamity, he's praying to God, he's calling unto God, he's crying out to God because he saw his country like being a mighty ship just simply hitting the ground on the rocks of rebellion. Three times he cries out, verse 3, turn us again, O God. Cause your face to shine and we shall be saved. Look in verse 7. Turn us again, O God of hosts. Cause your face to shine and we shall be saved. Verse 19, turn us again, O God of hosts. Cause your face to shine and we shall be saved. So he calls unto the shepherd, the great shepherd. The shepherd has that responsibility of protecting the sheep, of providing for the sheep. And you know, he sort of goes into what somebody has called a prayer full of nostalgic memories when he mentions Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh. And those were simply the descendants of Rachel, the wife of Jacob. And she was considered the mother of the northern kingdom. And so he appeals to the past and cries out to God, turn us. That's why the title of the message is, America, which way will you turn? Which turn are we going to take as a nation? We can turn towards God, or we can turn away from God. Three times it says, turn us again, O God. Turn us. You know, the Bible says, draw near unto God, and he will do what? Draw near unto you. And the psalmist is praying this prayer, turn us, O God. Turn us, cause your face to shine, and we shall be saved. And the question is, what will it take for us to turn back to God? I don't know about you, but that concerns me. What will it take to get our attention? You know, the psalmist here says, God, how long are you going to be angry against the prayer of your people? He says, in verse 5, you feed them with the bread of tears and you give them tears to drink in great measure. And such a picture here of today. What will it take for us to turn back to the Lord? Will it take a national calamity? Will it be a virus? Will it be a collapsed economy? Will it be the anarchy of the people? What is it that will cause us to turn back unto Him? And so you see this heartfelt prayer. The second thing I want you to notice is what I call the highlighted past. He begins to look at the past, and as he thinks about the past, look in verse 8. Thou hast brought a vine out of Egypt, thou hast cast out the heathen and planted it. Thou preparest room before it, and then caused it to take deep root, and it filled the land. The hills were covered with the shadow of it, and the boughs thereof were like the goodly cedars. She sent out her boughs unto the sea, and her branches unto the river. And so here in verse 8, he talks about, God, you did something. You brought a vine out of Egypt. Now we know the vine refers to the nation of Israel. God himself had given Israel the land of Canaan. And what did he do? He plucked them out of Egypt. The hand of God plucked them out of Egypt and planted them in a land that was flowing with milk and honey. He said, God, you did that. And you know, when you think about our nation, when you think about the odds back in the late 1700s of us winning against Great Britain and starting a new nation, the only conclusion you can make is what? God, you did that. You did that. And he said, it was your hand, God, that plucked the nation of Israel out of Egypt, and you planted them into this land flowing with milk and honey. And notice what he says here. You just prepared everything. You prepared room before. You did cause it to take deep root, and it filled the land. In other words, God, as he led Joshua and the people into the land, and they had victory after victory, it was because of God doing that. God had the conditions just right for Israel to flourish. And then he said, you prospered us. The hills were covered with the shadow of it. The boughs thereof were like the goodly cedars. She sent out her boughs into the sea, her branches into the river. It's talking about the Mediterranean Sea and the Euphrates River. And what he's simply saying is the fact that God, you caused the nation to spread out from the north to the south, from the east to the west. You have prospered us. That's what he's saying. He's thinking about the past, and he's thinking about the prosperity that the nation had. In the past, they were so powerful, they were so prosperous. They had enjoyed the unmatched favor of God. And I say, when we look at our past, we too have enjoyed the favor of God, haven't we? We too have enjoyed the blessings of God. How our past needs to be highlighted. No nation in history has blossomed like America. And contrary to the media and the liberal teaching of today, America was founded to be a Christian nation. Do you hear that? I mean, there's no denying it. When the pilgrims came to America, and how tragic, they tore down the statue of Christopher Columbus in Boston. They stated their express purpose for coming in what was known as the Mayflower Compact. And I'm quoting, this is why they said they came. For the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith. Did you hear that? They said, that's why we're coming. For the glory of God and for the advancement of the Christian faith. William Bradford, who was one of the first pilgrims, wrote these words. He said, whereas we all came into these parts of America with one and the same end and aim, namely, listen to this, to advance the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ and to enjoy the liberties of the gospel in purity with peace. I mean, you don't have to be a rocket scientist, and for people to deny that, you know, over a 10-year period, there were some political science professors at the University of Houston. And what they did, they collected and categorized 15,000 writings by the founding fathers. Now imagine this, 10 years studying over 15,000 writings by our founding fathers. And their goal in examining the sources that these men most quoted was to determine the primary source of ideas behind the Constitution. In other words, where did they get their sources from? How did they form these ideas here? They discovered that 94% of the Founding Fathers' quotes were based upon the Bible. Did you hear that? And we won't take the Bible out of schools today. We want the Bible to be ignored and rejected. 34% were directly from the Bible, and 60% from men who had used the Bible to arrive at their conclusions. Think about that. That's our past, people. That's our past. Patrick Henry said, "It cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians, not on religion, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ." That's our past. Asaph, as he was praying to God, he began to highlight the past of Israel. And I pray that truly in our nation today, there be a highlighting of our past, and we would do so well, because there are so many who are trying to destroy our past, or they're trying to distort our past. And there's no denying that our nation was founded on the principles of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So you have this prayer, a heartfelt prayer, crying to God. And you see the highlighting of the past. And then in this psalm, you see the third thing, what I call the horrible predicament. Look in verse 12. "Why hast thou then broken down her hedges, so that all they which pass by the way do pluck her? The boar out of the wood doth waste it, and the wild beast of the field doth devour it." You see, Israel had prospered, but something went wrong. Life had changed. And as you go back to verse 5, you find that he's expressing the sorrow that he feels over the land. "You feed them with the bread of tears and give them tears to drink in great measure." In other words, as somebody says, sorrow follows sin just as surely as night follows day. Israel's laughter had turned to tears, and she had tears to become her bread and drink. That's what verse 5 is saying. Have you ever seen somebody who was just in such a state of grief and despair, and you try to get them to eat and drink, and they wouldn't take anything? And it's like their bread and drink were their tears. In such sorrow. That's the sorrow that the psalmist is expressing, and such a sad state that in verse 6, he talks about the fact that, hey, our enemies laugh among themselves. The surrounding nations were mocking the nation of Israel. And my goodness, don't you see that happening today? That they've got to be laughing, these other countries, laughing at America. And then in verse 12, he comes along and says, "Why, God, have you broken down the hedges, the walls?" Now, anybody can come in and pluck the fruit. In other words, his protection and his presence had been withdrawn. And all of a sudden you find that Israel had become the prize and the plunder of all. Do you see that happening today? We talk about all these foreign countries that externally have so taken advantage of America and America's goodness, plundering our nation. And that's what he's talking about here, that anybody can just walk by and pass by. The walls are down, so we'll just steal your fruit. We'll just take your fruit. That's what's happening. America is being plucked by her enemies, externally and internally. Do you see what these folks are doing to our country when you watch the TV and the images there, and how the liberal agenda is being so promoted? And it's just like they're taking away, they're simply plucking away the things that we hold dear. Folks, I'm telling you, we better wake up, amen? Because they're plucking away those things which we hold so dear. What do we hold so dear? Faith. Christian faith. I mean, our country was founded on the faith of Christianity. few Wednesday nights ago, we were talking about the Muslims and studying what do Muslims believe. And what do you see happening in America? The Muslims are so slipping in such a casual way, gaining power in so many ways. You find, for example, that, you know, Christianity, the Bible, the church can be ridiculed. And the media does that all the time, don't they? But you never hear them ridicule Muhammad. You never hear them ridicule Islam. You know why? Because folks have gotten so much power in Washington and other places that it's not allowed. You don't make fun of Allah. You don't make fun of the Quran. You don't make fun of Islam. You don't do that. But it's okay to do that with Christians and the Bible. You see, they're trying to pluck away our faith. They're trying to pluck away the family. My goodness, did you ever dream you would live in a country that would legalize same-sex marriages? Can I tell you one of the saddest scenes I have ever seen in my lifetime was when that took place and our president ordered the White House to have the rainbow colors showing. That's one of the saddest scenes in America, and the tragedy is so many so-called Christians voted to put that man in office. And so many Christians are voting to put these people in office who are so against the values of the Word of God. Isn't that tragic? They're seeking to pluck away that which is so dear in America, the sanctity of human life. It is sad anytime anyone dies. Certainly the issue with George Floyd was sad, but literally thousands of lives are taken every day through abortion, and yet you don't hear anything about that. What I'm simply saying is we are at this point here where the walls have been taken down and our country is being plundered. And those values that we hold so dear are being plucked away. And then he says, and he describes it so brilliantly here, the boar out of the wood, in other words, the wild hog does what? Waste it, and the wild beast of the field does devour it. And here's the horrible predicament. He said, it's like these wild animals are simply coming in and rooting up the very vine that God has planted. In other words, not just content with eating the fruit, but literally destroying the vine. And that's the picture. You see, that hog is not content just to feed on the fruit. It roots out the vine. And that's exactly what's happening in America today. And those who are trying to distort and to destroy the roots, and they totally want to change life in America. That's what's happening to us. When you hear about the craziness of wanting to defund the police, is that not crazy? When you look at the tearing down of statues, when you look at the looting of stores, it looks like a bunch of wild animals. And Asaph looked at his country and he said, it just looks like a bunch of wild animals are trying to come in and literally destroy our land. That's the predicament. He went on to say in verse 14, return, we beseech thee, O God of hosts, look down from heaven and behold and visit the vine and the vineyard which thy right hand's planted and the branch that thou hast made strong for itself. It is burned with fire, it's cut down. What he's talking about there is the fact, O God, your judgment. Dr. Rogers said this. He said, not only is God our only hope, he's our biggest threat. You see, when we reject God, he went on to quote someone that said this, we don't know when the dam of God's mercy will give way to the waters of God's wrath. God has been so merciful to us, and we've experienced the waters of you know, the you know, the blessings of God's mercy, but there comes a time the dam's going to break and we're going to be flooded with God's wrath. And that was the prayer that this Asaph prays as he thought about the past, as he looked at the horrible predicament that his country was in. But then verses 14 through 19 talk about the last thing, what I call the hopeful plea. The hopeful plea. He says in verse 4, O Lord God of hosts, listen to this. How long will thou be angry against, listen to this. It just hit me so hard when I really saw that in this verse. The prayer of thy people. Did you hear that? God, how long will you be angry against the prayer of your people? In other words, you know, people say, we need to pray, we need to pray. Well, you can pray all you want, but the prayer of an unrepentant people only moved God to what? Anger. You see, we want the blessings of God. You know, we pray because, Lord, we don't want the stock market to crash. I mean, we don't want the terrorists to win. We don't want our standard of living to go down. So we pray many times because, you know, we enjoy the blessings that God has bestowed upon us. But that's why we pray. But if our hearts are not right with God, if there's an unrepentant spirit in us, then God won't answer our prayers. In fact, the psalmist said it stirs up God's anger there. And so he shares with us here the plea. Verse 17, let thy hand be upon the man of thy right hand, upon the son of man whom thou madest strong for yourself. When you read about the son of man, who do you think he's talking about? He's talking about, I think, Jesus Christ here. In verse 15, he referred to the branch. And then in verse 17, the man, they say, in the original language, you find that's the same word. And here he's talking about the fact that this branch, this man, this son of man, he's describing Jesus Christ. In other words, there must be a return to the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, Israel was that vine, but there was that special branch out of that vine. You see the picture? Israel was that vine, but out of Israel, out of that vine, came the branch. And the branch is the Son of Man. And there must be a return to him. And he says in verse 18, so will not we go back from thee. Quicken us, and we will call upon your name. In other words, God, move in our nation. Move in our midst. Quicken us. Revive us again. And what happens? And then turn us again, O Lord, God of hosts. Cause your face to shine, and we will be saved. I know we're out of time this morning, but as you really look at that, those verses simply are simply saying the answer is Jesus Christ. And to turn back to God. And that's why the question this morning is for our nation. We're at the crossroads. America, which way will you turn? But then I have to ask myself and look in my own heart, which way will I turn? The Bible says, if my people which are called by my name shall do what? Humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then God will do what? He will heal our land. He will heal our land. It's easy to talk about what's going on in our nation, but I have to ask in my own heart, what about me? Being at the crossroads, will I turn to God? or will I turn away from him? And our nation, right now, which way are we going to go? Turn us, O God, so that your face would shine upon us. You get the picture? It's not God that has to turn. We've turned our back on him. His face is still shining, but we don't see it. You know why? We don't experience it. Because we've turned our backs toward him. Turn us again, O God, that your face may shine upon us. He wants his face to shine upon us. He wants to save us. But he can't do it if our backs are turned. We have to turn toward him. I'm going to ask with their heads bowed and eyes closed this morning. Maybe this morning you would be at the crossroads individually, yourself. And the Holy Spirit is asking, which way are you going to turn? Would you turn toward him? Would you repent of your sins and place your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? And friend, if you've never done that before, I pray that today would be that day that you would do that. Today, maybe we as Christians today, we may come and say, oh God, we want you to heal our land, but yet we've not dealt with the sin in our own hearts and lives. And today the Holy Spirit is speaking to us and getting us to turn back to him. Whatever God would be leading you to do today, just act in faith. Oh God, we know our land needs healing, but it begins with us individually. And I just pray that today that we would examine our own hearts, and you clearly said revival begins with your people. So God, whatever you would have us to do, whatever decision you'd have us to make, help us to do that which would please you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And this morning, as we have a hymn of invitation, if you would be here and you say, preacher, I've never turned to the Lord. I've never trusted him as my Lord and Savior. So today I come and place my faith and trust in him and follow him in believer's baptism. Let me tell you, it's the greatest decision you ever make. And then also for us as Christians, you know, there are times we get away from God, we rebel against God, and we need to come back to him. And you know, we need to come back to him and trust in him and live for him. You know, when I look at what's happening in our nation today, it's all a breakdown of our faith and our families. Let me tell you, those folks who are doing that looting and everything, if they had the right raising in the family, they wouldn't be doing that. They were not taught respect for authority. They were not taught respect for people's possessions. They were not taught that. And that's a result of leaving God out of their life. And so, you know, we need to get back to those things that the Bible says are, you know, going to bless our nation. And it starts with us as the people of God. If you're here and God's leading you to join the church family, we'd love for you to come. So as we stand, as we sing, you come.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And by saying being in love with the Lord Jesus Christ, that doesn't mean that we don't have a righteous anger about what's going on today. And there's that part. And so hey, we truly communicate to our world that, hey, it's worth knowing Jesus Christ and the difference he can make. So may we do that. So thank you for being here today. We want to have a word of prayer, and we'll ask our ushers to stand at the door. We are not passing the plate because of the social distancing type of stuff, but they'll have plates here at the door. Brother Roy, y'all can come on in. And they'll be at the door. And if you are a guest today, I hope you filled out a card and you'll place that in the offering plate too. And we hope everyone will come and join us for the meal. We have plenty of food. And like I said, the tables are spread out and it'll be passed out in a way that hopefully you'll feel comfortable and safe. Okay? All right. Any announcements before we have our prayer? Anyone? All right. Well, let me have a prayer and for our offering, and we'll have the blessing for the food, and then after that, Brother John, if you'll lead us in a closing song, and everyone head to the gym, okay? Y'all look hungry and sleepy today. All right. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much again for this great land in which we live. Boy, we realize that literally thousands have given other lives that we could enjoy the freedoms that we enjoy today. Lord, forgive us for taking these blessings for granted. Forgive us, oh God, for when our hearts are not right. Oh God, as the psalmist prayed, Lord, would you just turn us back to you and cause your face to shine upon us and save us. We know Jesus is the only hope. And so, Lord, I just pray that we would just be that kind of people who would be praying and burdened just like Asaph was. God, we pray for this offering that it may go to further your kingdom, and that people may have the opportunities to hear the gospel to respond to you. And God, we just thank you as we can gather in a gymnasium and to eat and have no fear of being persecuted. That we can enjoy fellowship and food, and we realize that blessing comes from you. So we thank you and we praise you. Lord, we're grateful for all you do in our lives, and most of all, grateful for your son, Jesus, who paid the ultimate price upon the cross of Calvary. It's in his name I pray. Amen. Good job. Close this up.